restriction rules and all Vishnupada, Shukrashtra, Shimata, both were top Vasudhantis and Bhakta. And my and all glories to Bhakti Vedanta Tridandi Maharaj.
Oh, Kijai!
Kijai!
One Bhakti Vedanta is here. Yes. Perfect.
Very big one.
Yes, you can check me.
Not from here.
No, Prasanatma, he has...
You didn't see this screen yesterday?
Yesterday was on standby.
Standing Jagannath...
Someone standing there? Or
what? It's more... Four times more expensive just to send it. So we're reading from Vedanta Sutra, not extensively, of course, because there's 555 sutra. The ideal would be to have one day for one sutra. Some don't necessarily mean, sometimes it's just one word.
Is it possible to have microphone?
Yeah. Oh, yes. No, it's not, because it's not here.
I think they're on a program.
In the room is not that up. Okay, there's something.
Just imagine it's fun.
And yeah.
Then we will hear clearly.
Yeah, well, if I speak loud, you know,
yes,
everybody will listen. And you... So the idea will be to spend like 6 months, a year to study this and to seriously study it and try to read also the Upanishad and Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. All this together, but in a nutshell,
alongside as it is being referred to, or completely.
What?
Read Bhagavad Gita, Upanishads, Bhagavatam.
To help
alongside
understand
as it's being referred to.
No, yes, just along the, you know, along reading this book, just to understand better the deep subject of this. Because, like I said, the problem is not the difficulty is not Vedanta. The difficulty is philosophy. You don't believe me, but it's true. Some people have a pretty hard time grasping what philosophy means. They think it's just a world jugglery, very difficult, abstract idea, and not relating, and not very sweet, very dry, and boring. Because if you don't go into the subject, of course it's boring. And you have to be, to endeavor to go into the subject. Nobody is born a philosopher. You become a philosopher out of interest. You need to have some interest and endeavor. Of course, some people, even if they have interest and endeavor, they're still not philosopher. What to do? But the idea of philosophy as we defined it is not just world juggling. It's to learn how to live better and to learn how to be more happy and have less confused ideas and not being gullible. It is possible that you may choose a spiritual master who happens not to be a very advanced spiritual master and disappoint you. You can call this bad luck, or you know, you were sincere, you did the right thing, and this person is not up to, so you go find another spiritual master to have the truth. But I have known some people who got three spiritual masters of the same kind. The only thing I can tell them, no, I don't say it, but the only thing I can think of, you know, why am I so unlucky finding only a bogus spiritual master? Well, the reason is simple, you're stupid. You don't say it, I don't say it like this, but you know, like, you haven't learned why you take exactly the same kind. You have to look for someone who can has some kind of the different approach, something, you know. And besides, why you want a spiritual master? That is a big question also. Why do you want a guru? You know, it says, Tad dikinartam sa guru medabhigachet, or Tasmat guru prapadita jikyasu vishriya uttama. You have to inquire. You have to inquire about what is your ultimate good, shreya uttama, ultimate good. This is why you approach a spiritual master. Not just because you can cook, or you can go on the altar, or you think, oh, now my duty is done. Sometimes people think, now I have received diksha, I don't have to do anything anymore. He's going to save me, and I don't have to know my spiritual master, I don't have to serve him, I don't have to try to please him, be close to him, and so on and so forth. So the subject matter here is all about this also, of course. How we can progress in spiritual life. We've seen how the worship of Brahman, actually Brahman, it's just a general name, and more specific is Paramatma. More specific is Bhagavan. And Srila Jiva Goswami, he explains that all this is a gradation. More closer you come to Brahman, the more you actually discover Bhagavan. And you can meditate. It's a little difficult to meditate on Brahman because Brahman is not representable. But Paramatma, you can meditate on Vishvarup, the universal form, or Angushta Matram, this is the little supersoul within the heart, or you can meditate on the different avatar, Rishinga, Bhamana, Bharaha, Ram, or you can worship also Daru Brahma. You know who is Daru Brahma?
Jagannath.
Yeah, Jagannath. Jagannath. Brahma in the form of wood. This is how they say that Brahman is manifested in the form of wood. And Bhagavan also is worshipped everywhere. This is also was one topic that we didn't go through. Sarvagata is actually worshipped everywhere. In the fifth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, it is described how on every different varsha portion of the universe, a different avatar is being worshipped. There's a place where it's worshipped Nishinga, where is worship Ayagriva, where Ram is worshipped. Everybody is a monkey and they're worshipping Ram. Not maybe, but it's Kim Purusha Bhakta, actually Kim Purusha. This word was given when the creation were made of a form that looks like human. So they ask Kim Purush, Purush means man. Kim, are they human? But they're not monkeys. They have speech and they can think and they can do things that human being can do, and they have actually more power than some human. So Kim Purusha Anuman is a Kim Purusha. Kinara also. In Greek we call them centaurs. You know, Kinara is the half man, half horse. And so many other gods and so many demons also in the lower planetary system, also Sutala for example, also different avatar being worshipped, Bhamanadev in Sutala. And also in Patala, it's the Anantashesh. Everywhere you can worship Bhagavan. So the question that is asked in the first part of the first chapter, are Shudra qualified to worship Bhagavan? Are Shudra qualified to study Veda, Vedanta? What do you think?
Yes.
Why?
Because everybody has the right to worship Krishna, so no but God.
Because Jagannath means the Lord of the universe, so everybody should worship him. That's what they think here in the temple of Jagannath.
They don't.
You agree? Everybody should. Shudra eligible to study Veda and to meditate on Brahman, worship Bhagavan.
Depending on their Gurudev, do we need a mic here?
Yes.
Well, if you have one, I don't have to strain my voice.
Can I just ask one clarification?
Yes.
To my mind, worshipping Bhagavan and studying the Vedas are not synonymous.
Yeah, okay. Meditate, so just put it that way. Study the Veda, Vedanta, and meditate on Brahma. It's different.
So they probably couldn't read Sanskrit to begin with.
They don't read Sanskrit.
It wasn't written for them.
No.
Accessible.
That was in code.
It's not accessible.
But according to the quality of the person, not according to their birth, but according to their quality and the quality of their Gurudev.
Yeah.
Because by the power of...
But the question is in general way. Can a Shudra, is a Shudra eligible to read Veda, Vedanta and meditate on Brahma?
Well, he wouldn't have the faculties to be able to do that.
Mami parta dipasritra yevi supapayonya sriya vaishas tata shudra yeviyanti paravati.
Yeah. What does that mean?
That anyone from those Shudras taking sinful birth or Vaishyas, whoever, if they surrender to me, Ashritya means.
But this verse doesn't say they can read Veda, study Vedanta, and
Kiva Vipra, Kiva Nyasi, Shudra Kinya, Ye Krishna Tattva Veda, Se Guru Vats. So, according to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he wasn't interested in this caste system.
I understand. The question is more simple. I understand what you're saying. Okay. But the question that is asked is, can a Shudra study Veda, Vedanta, or meditate on Brahma? You said no.
Yes.
You say yes.
What time frame are you asking him?
What?
Which time frame are you asking the question?
At the time where it was written.
I say no.
Because today everybody is a Shudra, so...
Because, well, they wouldn't be able to pronounce the mantras.
They don't know Sanskrit anyway. They can't read. They didn't go to school.
Upanishads are filled with stories of other persons that were so-called Shudra birth, but by taking initiation from a bona fide spiritual master, became qualified and studied the Vedas, no matter what their birth.
Yes. But the question is, can a Shudra who has a mentality of a Shudra study Veda, Veda?
He's not interested. He's being Shudra.
Because one has to understand the meaning of Shudra and one has to understand the meaning of Brahmana. Because you said already many things. Guru, initiation, qualification, bhakti. So in a Vedanta Sutra, two stories are told from the Shandogya Upanishad. The first one is concerning Janashroti Putrayana. Janashroti was a... Well, it's not said in the text, but we can deduce that he was a Kshatriya because he was giving many things in charity. He was a very generous man. And once two rishi, they were flying over in the guise of Hamsa, swans. And they were speaking with each other. One says, look at the ashram of Janashruti. He's a very generous person. He gives in charity. He's, you know, like a very good person. And the other one is saying, why you even mention his name? I know a better person. He's called Rekva Muni. And this Janashruti cannot equal him at all. You know, he's such an insignificant comparative. So when Janashruti heard those two swans speaking, he overheard them. You know, it's like in childish stories that the birds also can speak. Can you hear me better? When Janashruti heard that someone was being glorified as being better than him, then he became all depressed. Then he went to see Rekva. Actually, the people in those days, you know, when they heard that someone was better than them, they will go to that person to accept initiation. See, not like today, you know, like we will feel upset and we'll try to defame that other person. So he went to Rekva Muni. Actually, he was looking for him for some time.
So for the those who have a hard time hearing, it's getting better. The it's pretty interesting.
Go to India.
I keep on talking. So, yes, I think it's good. So he wants to know who is this Rekva Muni. He sends some servants, and at first, he's looking for him. At first, they don't find him, but he says, try to look among the people who are not so important. And they find someone who's living behind, below, taking shelter of a chariot. That's why they call him Chitrarata also in the Vedanta Sutra, Chitrarata. And so they went, came back to Janashruti, said, we found him. He looks very simple. He's crushing all this sore body and he's living underneath a chair. And so he went to see him, Janashruti, bringing present. This is a thing. Not only you think, oh, you heard someone is better than me, I'm going to go and learn from him, but I'm going to bring presents. So he brings many horses, gold, and servants, cows, and so many things. And the Rekva Muni, when he sees him, he says, hey, Shudra, why you want to give me these things? Take those things with you and turn back. Then he, Janashruti, he comes back again and he offers even more gold, more cows, and his own daughter also for marriage. And again he's being addressed as Shudra. But finally, Rekva Muni is going to instruct him. But it's not written why, in the Shandarga Upanishad, it's not written why he's being addressed as a Shudra, even though he probably is from Kshatriya birth. But the commentator, they explain that in Govinda Bhasha, another book, the Madhvacharya also, they explain he's a Shudra because he's lamenting. One who laments is a Shudra. One who thinks pity, self-pity, depression, poor me, he's a Shudra. Now this is the number one disease in the West, you know, mental disease, depression. People live in Shudra society, everybody is lamenting. I keep on telling the people in Europe, we are fortunate because our generation, we didn't live through a war. They have a hard time understanding my words, you know, but there's war here, they said, there's no war in your country. Yes, but there's terrorists and everything. But that has nothing to do with the real war. This is a really terrible thing to live, you know. I was in my youth, you know, we were selling Bhagavad Gita in Lebanon during the war, you know, and you could hear the bombs, you know, and see. It's scary. It's really scary. But we could escape, you know, some people, they have to stay there. So, and economy, no matter what, it's not that bad, we're still very privileged. Look at all these people living in the street with nothing, next to the temple, with no hands, no feet. And we always feel so sorry for us. I keep on hearing all this time, you know, all the time I keep on hearing, this is getting worse and worse, it's never been as bad. I say, what about World War II? What about the Cold War? What about, I don't know, so many wars, so many... What about the plague, you know, when they had this plague in Europe, it killed one third of the population in about 2 months, you know, a few million people. In the 15th century,
Black
plague. You know, it came from China. It's the ticks, you know, they're not on the
rats.
Not the rats. The ticks on the rat. Yes. And then it spreads like crazy. You know how people living in those times. You know they. It must have been sounding like the end of the world. So anyway, but we think we are so, you know, to poor us. And this is Shudra mentality.
not talking about anybody in particular, just saying. So this is true. A brahmana should not lament. Then you have the story of Jabala Satyakama, just the story afterwards in the Shambhagya Upanishad, and is also mentioned or referred to in Vedanta Sutra. Jabala Satyakama approached Gautama Rishi and he wants to have initiation from him, and he says, what is your gotra? What is your lineage? He said, I don't know, I'll ask my mother. So he goes and asks his mother, he said, mother, because he doesn't have a father and he doesn't know who's his father. So, mother, what is my gotra? So she answers and said, when I conceived you, I known so many men that I don't know who is your father. So he goes back to the Rishi and says, well, that's what she said. My mother has known so many men, so I don't know who is my father, I don't know what gotra I belong to. And Gautama Rishi said, you must be a brahmana. Only a brahmana will speak such unpalatable truth. Because what you mean is that I'm a bastard, you know, that like I don't have any father, I don't know who could be my father. My mother, she slept around with anybody. And you say that openly. Because the definition of a brahmana is one who speaks the truth. And the definition of a shudra, someone who is always duplicity, hypocrisy, never straight. So then he says, bring wood for the fire, I will initiate you. Then he initiates him. And from probably a shudra that he was from birth, he becomes a brahmana. And this is also, like you said, many have changed from their... They were shudra, they became brahmana by initiation. By proper initiation, by a proper guru, you can become a brahmana. And in Mahabharata, Vishvamitra is a kshatriya by birth, is always fighting with Vashishta Muni, who is a brahmana. Then seeing the power of Vashishta, because they keep on stealing each other the cow, you know, they teach. Then he wants to take a vow of making very deep austerity to become a brahmana. And he becomes a brahmana. He changes his stature. And many other examples are there. For example, Rishabdev, the king, Rishabha, the king, the son of King Nabi, he had 100 sons. And 9 of them were kings. And 9 of them were sages. The Nava Yogendra, and 81 were Brahmana.
I have a question. You're mentioning that Sudra is always crooked and duplicitous. I'd like to understand how that ties in with, you know, someone who works with their hands is a Sudra, someone who's weaving baskets, someone who's an artisan and carving the meat, and even a doctor is considered Sudra, from what I've heard. So that would be mean they're working with their hands, they're serving others. Oh yes, there's
oh, because we're trying to define who is a brahmana, vaishya, shudra, kshatriya according to his work or his mentality. First of all, I'm just trying to say the mentality.
But that seems like a conflict to me, because you could have someone who's weaving baskets, who's always honest, who, you know, never
crooked. That's exactly what I mean. First you have to examine personal character before judging what he's doing. You can classify, you know, oh, this is brahmanical work, this is shudra's work, this is... But what is the mentality behind the person who is acting? Most people weave basket and everything, they're not even shudra. They consider outcast.
Are you like, well, a doctor is technically because he's serving others?
No, it's because he's touching blood.
Mm-hmm. Because
he has his blood on his hands, so he's considered to be impure.
Because the Vaishya, Kshatriya, and the Kshatriya, they don't work for others, so I was taught that, but
but this is again, this in this conception of the, you know, caste system, you know, like it is very, very well defined. But first of all, let's try to understand the mentality.
This boy was called Satya Kama. Kama means the desire. Satya means truth. He has the desire to learn the truth, and therefore he was a Brahmana, even though he was born as a Shudra or he was born with no caste. And this Jana Shruti, he was born a Kshatriya, but because he was lamenting that he was behaving as a Shudra. So before defining what is the work that does a Brahmana or Kshatriya or Vaishya Shudra, we have to understand what is the mentality. This is what Krishna defines in Bhagavad Gita. Shamo Damastapash or Sham Kshamtir Ajavahi Vachas. You know the qualities. What are the qualities? Prabhupada will quote those verses very often. What are the qualities, first of all, of a Brahmana, of a Kshatriya? If you are very, you like to fight and you like, you're very heroic and you are not afraid, this is a Kshatriya quality. But if you are humble, you like to study, you like to teach, you tolerate, you're mellow, then it's more Brahminical qualities. And if you like to make money and you like to be generous and welcome people and take care of land and cows and business, then more Vaishya quality. And if you're an artist, you know, so Shudra's quality is to like to serve. There are people like this, you know, they like to render service to others. Vaishnava anyway, he's behaving in any way that is fit, you know. He will clean the toilet, which is the work for Shudra, and he will be happy because this is the work for Vaishnava. But first of all, this is the spirit that has to be understood. What is the quality of a person? Who is a Brahmana? Actually, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur, when he was very young, his father was supposed to give a lecture to speak on the Smarta Brahmana, those who follow the Smriti, that's why they call Smarta. Not because they're smart, but because they follow Smriti, Shastra, the Shruti and Smriti. Shruti are the main texts, the Rig Veda, the Brahmana, and the Upanishad. And Smriti are the texts that are concocted or written by men. Shruti is apurushaya, not created by man, and Smriti is created by man to explain what Shruti is saying. The best example of a Smriti is Manu Smriti, Manu Samhita or Manu Smriti. And the Smarta Brahmana, then they think that you can only become a Brahmana by birth. If you are in the family of a Brahmana, immediately you will become a Brahmana. And you have superiority to other people. Yes.
Don't they also believe that in Kali Yuga there is no Brahmana?
No, the Brahmana of this day, they don't believe this. We do.
Isn't it part of the scripture that says that?
Yes, the many scripture will say that. But the problem is they don't accept all scripture. They only accept their scripture. Not necessarily Shruti, by the way. They accept mainly the Griya Sutra, Shruta Sutra, Sutra that were written, you know, to define what is Dharma. What is important for a Brahmana is to define what is Dharma and doing many rituals. It's very difficult to translate the word Brahmana into English. Sometimes we translate as priest, but there's no priest. You know, like the understanding of priest in religion is like there's a hierarchy. But there's no such thing, you know, in India, it's a hierarchy. Someone will be responsible for all the Brahmana. One is a Brahmana and he's doing what he has to do, he's learning and he's teaching. So he's also teaching, he's also doing some sacrifice and telling others to do sacrifice. He's getting charity, giving charity. Those are the six activities of a Brahmana. So it's a little difficult to translate, but Smarta Brahmana, or whatever they call themselves now, Pandit or whatever, they certainly don't accept our scriptures, who says that everybody is a Shudra in this age of Kali, or demons take birth as Brahmana just to torture the Vaishnava. As Chaitanya Bhagavat, he says that. They certainly don't accept this kind of scriptures, and they consider us to be really unqualified. if you ask any of those panda from Jagannath temple, you know, why we cannot enter, first of all, they don't even have the right answer, but they'll say, you, if you want, you, next birth. In your next birth, don't even think of it in this birth, unless somehow they change, you know, because it's always a discussion, you know, the traditional, the old people traditional, they just don't want at all any compromise. But some new generation, they say, yes, but, you know, we'll bring more money, and they have money, more people, and they have money, they can maintain. Anyway, but their discussion is not based on Shastra, it's based on privilege. I was born as a Brahmana, therefore I have some kind of a privilege, and you don't. You consider outcast, mlecha, you have an outside. So, if we are devotees, then we should not be feeling grief by being rejected, not being a shudra. Just accept, okay, Sanatana Goswami, Rupa Goswami, Haridasa Thakur, they were all coming. They were all considered to be outside the system, but they accepted. Okay, we're not coming.
In this context, I think for us, in our bhajan and our mental sanity, it's always important to keep aware of this difference between religion, religious traditions, religious rules, religious aberrations, and spirituality.
Yeah.
We are so often mixing them or thinking they're equal. No, they're not. They can be quite opposite, actually. And especially when we are advancing, we should keep aware of this, because it appears to us very often as we go along our path that religion mixes in our spiritual practice, that spirituality.
We become intolerant.
Yes.
And dogmatic.
We're going this way, which is not the way of our acharyas. Definitely not.
Actually, every religious teacher who wanted to reform their religion, they went along this path.
They always broke, like Gurudev or his Gurudev, they broke away from their own organizations just to keep the line.
Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he accepted Haridasa Thakur and Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami, they were considered Muslims. And Roy Ramananda also was considered a Shudra. So he accepted that, even though he was born of a Brahmin family. Yamuna Acharya's guru was considered to be a Shudra. Ramanuja Acharya's, because he could not really have instruction and guidance of Yamuna Acharya. So he accepted different Acharya in the line, in the Shri Vaishnava line of Yamuna Acharya. And they were all Shudra, well, at least one or two were Shudra. Actually, this is the reason why he left his wife, because the wife of one of his guru, I forgot his name, somehow she touched her when she was fetching water. And she considered, you have contaminated me.
Deva.
Yes. And she made a big fuss. And the guru didn't say a word. He and his wife, they just left the Kanchipuram, you know, and they ran back to Sri Ranga. But when Ramanuja Acharya heard this, he was very furious, and he decided to break away from his wife, but, you know, on the pretense, you know. He sent her away saying, there's a wedding, you should attend, and then he took all his belongings and left, because he considered she made a big offense to my guru. She thinks that he is a Shudra, when he's actually Paramahamsa. This is the thing, that Shudra Brahmana doesn't matter. If you were born in such and such family, the character, that is what is important, what you're doing, and if you're a Vaishnav. Anyway, this Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was sick. He had a fever, but in a very hoarse voice he said, would there be anybody to challenge all this Smartha Brahmana who makes so many problems towards the Vaishnav? And rectify, you know, what they're saying. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur, Bimar Prasad, at that time, young man, he wrote and addressed a 3-day speech and concerning called Brahmana and Vaishnavas. He's very young.
27.
37. And the first part, the first day is called Prakrita Jan Kanda. Jan means birth according to Prakriti, according to nature. This is according to the Jati. You were born as a Brahmana. This is the section concerning birth as according to nature. The second one is called Arijan Kanda, born according to nature. So in the Prakrita Jan Kanda, then he's discussing different type of Brahmana. 24 actually, different types. I'm not going to read everything, but just some extract. One should reject the following Brahmana: those with missing limbs, those with extra limbs. If you have an arm coming from your head. Those who behave unjustly, hypocrites, those who falsely accept the signs of some statue, like professional astrologers, professional priests, physicians, the sons of unmarried women, priest of the Shudra, priest of the untouchable, those who associate with fallen person, those who are ignorant of the Veda, those who reject the father, mother, spiritual master, the sacred fire, or the study of the scriptures. Such persons are considered to be the worst kind of Brahmana and are disgraced to their line. Then many verses are quoted again, and it says there are 10 kinds of Brahmana mentioned in the scripture. 10 names for them. One is called Deva, another Muni, another Dvija, Rajas, Vaishya, Shudra, Nishada, Pashu, Mlecha, Chandala. And he gives different definitions of this. For example, I'm not going to quote them all also. One who gives up all association and spends all his time reading Vedanta and studying Samkhya Yoga is called a Dvija Vipra. He's some Dvija, twice born, but the meaning learned, Vipra, yes. One who likes to cultivate the land, protect cows and other animals, or accept professionals of trade and commerce is called a Vaishya Brahmana. One who sells varnish, salt, sunflower oil, milk, honey, or meat is called a Shuddha Vipra. One who is a thief or a rogue, who gives bad counsel, who is a betrayer, who bites with his harsh words, and who is always greedy to eat fish and meat is called a Nishada Brahmana. That means outcast.
But they can eat meat and fishes and be a Brahmana.
Here it says selling, but now they eat here also. But, you know, there's an example.
No, we know, but that's not true.
One who is devoid of pious activities, who is a fool, completely irreligious and merciless to all living entities, called Chandala Brahmana. Yes, they can also be a fool, irreligious and merciless. No, they're not. They're Brahmana in name only. Brahma Bandhu, this is the thing. That, you know, they're only Brahmana in name only. That's the thing. We still have the character, you know. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta is also saying that, you know, at the age of 8, between the age of 8 to the age of 16, this is the ideal time for one who is born in a Brahmanic whole family to go to Gurukul and be to follow all the study and take Upanayana, that means second birth, the third ceremony. After the age of 16, it's considered too late. They don't do it before the age of 16, then he's considered a Shudra. He has to have his samskar, you know, it's very important. At least 10 samskar are there for a Brahmana. And one of them is Upanayana. He received this thread, usually from his father, who is a Brahmana, and so on and so forth. But they go and study for 12 years. Normally they study for 12 years the Veda. They really follow the Brahmanical rules. But Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur is saying, if they are studying just to get money, in other words, I'm a Brahmana, now I can do the rituals and the people will give me dakshin and then I will get good salary, that is one type of mentality. And sometimes study of the Veda would not be fruitful for this, so therefore he will, because it's a little technical, a little complicated to do, so he will study Dharma Shastra, the codes of Dharma that explain how to do the rituals in order to earn his livelihood. And if it still doesn't work, then he will teach Purana, Because Purana, even Shudra can hear. Purana, Mahabharata, Stri Shudra Dvija Bandhunam, it says in Srimad Bhagavatam, that it was written for Shudra, for women, because women were considered not eligible to read the Veda in those times. And Dvija Bandhu is someone who is twice born but doesn't behave according to his rank, so therefore he's degraded. So you can have the title Brahmana or title Kshatriya, but be actually degraded from that rank. And so he can teach Purana to earn his livelihood. If he doesn't earn his livelihood teaching Purana, then he will cultivate the land. And if he doesn't earn his livelihood cultivating the land, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur is saying, then he can become a spiritual master of the Vaishnava and therefore accumulate wealth and followers. Finally. Anyway, those are the wrong type of Brahmana. It's not like you should do this. It says that Brahmana was greedy for money. He cannot get money with reciting Veda and doing Vedic sacrifice, then he would follow Dharma Shastra. If he cannot do Dharma Shastra, he would do Bhagavad Saptaha. Like so many places you have this Bhagavad Saptaha, it attracts so many people for giving money, and then you can get very rich and fat. Mm-hmm. Because you eat ghee. And if you can't do this, then you can become a Vaishya, cultivate the land. And if you unsuccessful with this, you become a guru. Anyway, this is being sarcastic, you know, but it's just to show the degradation of this Brahmana, because the Brahmana, the definition of Brahmana is someone who knows Brahman. If you don't know Brahman, then you are not Brahmana. And then this, I quoted this verse before, Yajnavalkya to the woman, Gargi, is saying, one who leave this world without cultivating the knowledge of Akshara Brahma is a kripana. He lives miserly. He lives poorly. But one who actually have learned to know this Brahman, he is called a Brahmin. He's a real Brahmana. One who knows Brahman, he is called Brahman, Brahmana. And Pancharatra, in this age of Kali, because you said something about the age of Kali, or scriptures saying that in this age no one is qualified, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was saying Kalo Shudra Sambhava, that everybody, and Srila Prabhupada was quoting off from this Janmana Jayate Shudra, when you are born a Shudra. It's only the samskara, the purification process, you know, the different ceremony that is given, Garbhadhan, Samskara, then before conception, then at birth, then the first, the calling of the name, you give a name, then after that, the first grain, you know, Gurudev is often doing this, giving first grain to the child, and then you cut also the first hair, and so on and so forth, Vivaha Yajna, of course, the wedding ceremony, then before wedding, there was the Upanayana, the receiving of the sacred thread, and so on and so forth. One is a Brahmana by all these different samskara. But it says in the scripture there's three births actually. The natural birth, Shukra, then the second birth, Savitra, and the third birth is called Deksha, by Diksha, or Yagik. You know, in the story, this is one kind of demon. I don't know if you're covering this one. The little Gopa, they said to Krishna, the demon of hunger is torturing us. You know, and they, there's many different times they are saying this. The story of Devukasura, but also in the story of they're in the forest and they approach the Brahmins. Mm-hmm. And the Brahmins, they say, no. So then Krishna say, go see the woman. Because the woman, they have kind heart. And of course Krishna is there, so they're attracted to Krishna. But then when the Brahman realized their mistake, they said to hell without three births. They mentioned the three births, you know, Shukra, Savitra, and Yagik. They called it Yagik or Deksha. That is the third birth is giving you the right to perform sacrifices and come closer to God. That is the idea. But it is written that in Kali Yuga, because of the complexity, the degradation of human capacity, no one can really be a perfect Brahmana or be born three times, according to Vedic rites. Nobody can be a Brahmana according to the Vedic rites. So therefore, Ramanuja Acharya, Madhva Acharya, Yamuna Acharya also was one of the first to speak about this. They introduced the Pancharatra. The Pancharatra are considered to be explanation of Veda or help of the Veda. They are not quite Vedic, but just as good, and they are more simple. Srila Prabhupada was often quoting Narada Pancharatra. So they are Tantra for Vaishnava, and we have Vaishnava Smritis, Vaishnava rituals that we can follow, all this samskara. You know, if you're a grihastha, you have to do all of these things. Garbhadan samskara, then Chuda samskara. There's so many. Srila Gopal Bhakta Goswami in the book, Satkriya Dipika. Satkriya Dipika. Yes. He describes all these different samskara and gives the different mantra to be recited. And also Srila Sanatana Goswami in Hari Bhakti Vilas also is giving different description. Those are called Smriti Shastra for Vaishnava. They can follow. And you can follow those samskara. And this is very interesting because there's no need to read the Vedic scripture. But actually Brahmana today, they don't read the Veda. They don't read Veda. And some of them don't even know Sanskrit. They don't read the original Veda and the original Brahmana. They read those text books that are accompanying. So they're called Smriti. They're also Smriti. That's why we call them Smarta. Those who follow Smriti are called Smarta. And the Pancharatra, it says that it can be for anyone. Even someone who is not a Brahmana by birth can be, if he's a Shudra, he can be initiated by a spiritual master and become a Brahmana. When we were young and we were given the Brahminical initiation, this is how Srila Prabhupada would call it, Brahminical initiation. He was saying you become a Brahman by this thread ceremony. With the Gayatri mantra, the Brahman Gayatri, and all the other Gayatri. And you have to recite Trisandhyam with singing every morning. In Guru Ashtakam, how we worship the spiritual master three times in Trisandhya. But we also recite the mantra. When I first met Gurudev, and I wanted to talk to him privately and seriously about the relationship with Guru, he said at one point, he said, you're a disciple of Swamiji, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. He said, where is your Brahmin thread? I said that, it was a long time. I said, I took it out. And he said, why? You have no faith in your Guru? Then Madhav Maharaj was in the bathroom, you know, I heard him saying, Guru Avagya. Meaning offense to the Guru. And I said, no, I don't have faith in me. So he said, I will give you back. So then my mind was a little racing, you know, quickly. I said, but that means you're going to become my Diksha Guru? He said, no. Your Diksha Guru is Swamiji, but I will reconfirm you're going to take again. And so I had to do, you know, shave my head and do the fire sacrifice, and he was very happy. I shaved my head, he was really happy.
Yeah.
Oh, you look so beautiful. And every day after lecture, after class, he would come to me and he said, is it growing yet? He said, I can't wait, you know. But anyway,
what is Savitri? What's the difference between Jagya and Savitri?
Savitra means the, you know, when you're born as a Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, then at one point you are born. This is natural birth, Shukra. Then the second birth is when you receive this Brahminical thread. Vaishya kshatriya, brahmana, they receive this thing.
And then what is then this yagya?
Yagik or deksha is a diksha. It allows you to worship Bhagavan.
Then you already have the thread.
No. It's something more. That's the thing. That is a subtlety. You see, this if they like if you have nothing, if you were just born from ordinary parents with no gotra. By the way, you know which gotra you belong to?
Achyuta
gotra. Directly God. If anybody asks you what is your gotra, Achyuta. And then even the Indian they say, yes, this is the best.
The Pandas here don't exist.
Yes, they do. But they don't let you in. But if you chant mantra, you recite your gotra, which is Achyuta. Yes. Anyway, to finish my story of this initiation business with the spiritual master, Gurudev made me understood something I haven't understood before. If I took out my Brahmin prayers, because I certainly didn't want to be a Brahmana in the sense of this puffed up people who have a fat belly. I do have a fat belly, but that's a different reason, you know, because they feed on other people's donation and think that you understand and you know God better than others. I certainly didn't want to associate myself with this idea. If anybody also thinks that the Guru is giving you Brahminical initiation, then it is the reason that you should embrace religion in a sense of dogmatic and oppress people and thinking you're superior. This is totally wrong. Because he maybe understood one thing, the Guru gave you those mantras. And you have to be faithful to the Guru. And those mantras are the link to your Guru. And there's something more actually than the mantra. Because you know in the Brahma Gayatri that is not given to women. Gurudev explained, you know, in saying that women if they chant this mantra they will become like men and they don't need to have this mantra because they already have this prakriti nature, this female nature. So anyway, by giving the Brahma Gayatri, what the translation usually is, you know, in ISKCON I don't understand the word of what it says, but you know, it's talking about being enthused or something. But in the literal translation, it's a worship of the sun. We worship the sun, that is Savitra, that's why it's called Savitra, you know, and that rise and is Bhur, Bhuva, you know, Swaha in the three worlds and everything, and this is worship of the sun. This is not how Gurudev defined it. He says, you know, actually, Brahma Gayatri is the worship of Srimati Radhika. And then in the private room, you know, without men who was initiated, he clearly said, this is means that one day you will become a gopi. He said that. Shouldn't repeat, but he said that, literally. So his conception of Brahma Gayatri, it's all taken on top of this. But I heard one day that Srila Gurudev gave the Kamaga, Gopi Baba mantra in a mic in Navadvipa, and 30,000 people heard it. They basically received it. So, but I just want to mention the speciality of Gurudev. That when you receive Brahma Gayatri and all the Gayatri, it's not because you are qualified as a Brahman to perform yajna. According to this verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam, it says that one who chant the holy name only once, then to say nothing of the spiritual advancement of person who see the Supreme Person face to face. Even a person born in a family of a dog eater, I don't know if it is your case. I wasn't eating dog, but they eat strange things, you know, in my country. Person born in the family of a dog eater immediately becomes eligible to perform Vedic sacrifice if he once utter the holy name of the Supreme Person or chants about him, hear by him his pastime, offer him obeisance or remember. This is a verse from Srimad Bhagavatam, third canto. And Sridhar Swami is commenting on saying that this can take place immediately. Jiva Goswami, because he was instructing Brahmana and Vrindavan, he said that actually the person is clear of all his offenses, all his anatta, all his sin. But to perform Vedic sacrifice, he will have to wait next birth. But Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, he's saying now, immediately, immediately he can perform Vedic sacrifice. And so the idea of Brahminical initiation is that you can do all those sacrifices, worship the deity, cook for the deity, do the fire sacrifice for certain occasion like marriage, like other things, like initiation if you want to become a guru, that is your business. But you become qualified for this. But this is just, I may say, the external aspect. The internal aspect is that you're going to become dear through your Gurudev, who is a dear servant of Srimati Radhika. That is the internal aspect. And he gives the meaning of Ish Mantra also. Even the Guru Mantra is actually, he's following Srimati Radhika and not Krishna. But this is Gurudev, you know, he gives a very specific way, more rasik. And if we understand this, then this is something very private. You have to really relish it. It's not because you are superior, and you can do as all these priests in every religion. They have the best seat, they have the best dress, they have all the money, they have all the power, and that's what you crave for, that's what you're going to receive. Krishna is good with you, and Gurudev also will, he said, okay, that's what you want, you will get. But if you want Krishna Prema, that is a different thing. So you will have to endeavor and have to bear many difficulties and be still faithful to your Gurudev. He's giving you something unique. We don't realize it. It's unique. That's why Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur, he's not saying that someone who is initiated as a Brahma, initiated by a bona fide guru become as good as a Brahmana. He's saying that Vaishnava is better than Brahmana. Better be born in a low class family and be a devotee than being born in a high class family and be not a devotee. That is his purport. He's saying actually it's even better. So that's why it doesn't matter if your guru comes from a Shudra family or Chandala family. If he's a Vaishnav, if he's, because we come back to the character, it doesn't matter who does what, who cares, You're a doctor, you're saving life, very good. It doesn't matter if it is qualified as Shudra or Brahmana, who cares? And you can be a teacher and be a total Shudra. No, because working in that profession for so many years, I can see some people just lament. Age of Kali also, there's no yajna that can work. Nothing is actually proper. And so only Harinam yajna can be performed. This is the only thing that can be performed. So this is the purport of this very important passage of Vedanta Sutra. Can Shudra? The answer is no, by the way. The answer is no, but by this kind of explanation, who is a Brahmana, who is a Shudra? Not the one who is born a Shudra, not one who works as a Shudra, but one who has the mentality of a Shudra. Because do you have an example of many people, this Shridhar, who makes best... Yeah, he makes the leaves cup, and he this is very low class work, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is always joking with him and teasing him and stealing and... But they have very deep relationship. When we hear this story, our hearts melt because the relationship that they have. Yes.
I hope you don't mind,
blew
off what you're saying now. But you used the word tantra a few times. Yeah. A lot of the charyas used tantras.
Yamuna charya.
And you were talking about tantra.
Narada tantra.
It's
a tantra word. Yes.
It's a tantra.
Yes.
So usually in the West, tantra means something else. So
yes.
Can you define what is like tantra? What is
Purana? Yes, Vaishnava tantra and Shivaic tantra.
But what does tantra mean?
What does it mean?
Process.
It's a process. Yes. It has nothing to do with all this sex, sex education that goes on under the name of tantra. It's just some textbook that give you. Usually, esoteric meaning, tantra is usually explaining yantra, those diagram, you know, like you have the Shri Yantra, but that's for Durga worship, but you have also the Yantra of Srimati Radhika, Yantra, you know, those design, you know,
yes,
rectangular and everything with mantra. So it goes Tantra, Yantra, Mantra. Usually they go together. They are more mystical and more esoteric. That's why the Tantra are considered to be parallel to the Veda, because Veda, they teach mantra. But since nobody understands how to pronounce this mantra, and they're very complicated, Tantra makes it more easy.
So Tantra is
Shruti? No, it's not Shruti.
No.
It, it's Agama or Tantra. This is a parallel line. You could consider Smriti, really.
Yeah.
There is different levels for different...
Different level for
different
people, like Puranas.
Yeah, same. Tantras in the mode of ignorance, yeah. Tantras in the mode of passion, Tantras in the mode of goodness, and Tantras meant to obtain Sudhasattva.
Yeah, so the Tantra...
we follow what is approved and authorized by the Acharyas, those Tantras, like Pancharatrika.
Yes, Pancharatrika.
That is what we follow.
We follow this process of Pancharatrika. That is approved by the Acharya.
So literally it means the process?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
And Purana is like old, so what is different from... How is the Purana different from, Upanishad or...
They're different because they deal with stories mainly, and story within a story.
Historical.
And, yeah, and also yeah, they have different also historical events and you know they have five subjects. Bhagavatam puts 10 subjects. Vishnu Purana puts 5 subjects of different the Purana. But they are considered the fifth Veda along with Mahabharata. And it's the same thing, some Purana in the mode of passion, some in the mode of ignorance, and in the mode of goodness.
Upanishad would also have stories and histories. And
they have, I quoted 2 stories,
yeah,
from Upanishad, but the Upanishad stories are clearly to teach something.
And they're older?
And they're short. No, they're not necessarily older. Sometimes they're the same. You find them in the Purana. In Purana, they take also from Upanishads. You know, they take from each other. It's not like you have separated. Upanishad are called Jnanakanda. The Rig Veda, Sama Veda, Yajur Veda, along with the Brahmana explanation, they call Karma Kanda. And then all this Griya Sutra, Shrota Sutra that explain also the Karma Kanda, it's the same line. Meaning that the first meaning of karma is not the individual action. In the Gita, actually, when it condemns karma, it doesn't condemn necessarily the individual action. It condemns the karma linked with the yajna, karma kanda. And then it teaches that beyond karma kanda, there's jnana kanda. Jnana means that a brahmana is someone who understands that to act is a good thing, to act and sacrifice, but it should be towards the goal of purifying oneself. So the mode of passion should correct the mode of ignorance, and the mode of goodness should correct the mode of passion, and ultimately you should transcend the three guna and become nirguna. This is the meaning. And so this Jnana Kanda is saying that you're using the sacrifice and you should see Brahman everywhere. Brahmarpanam, Brahmahavir, Brahmagno, Brahmanahutam, Brahmeva, Dinagantavyam, Brahma Karma Samahina. The literal meaning is that Brahman is everything. The ladder that you're using, the fire, the ingredients, everything is Brahman. This is a literal meaning. Srila Prabhupada translates as everything becomes Krishna conscious, which is okay. Everything that you're using in a service of Krishna becomes spiritualized, let's say. But the literal meaning of the verse is everything is Brahman used. So in other words, there's a science to the sacrifice that you are doing this to attain some certain kind of reality which is mystical. This is the spirituality you were talking about. You have to transcend this religious aspect where you are entangled in order to get this spiritual aspect where you realize your own soul and you realize the soul of the sacrifice. When Maharaj Rishabha was doing sacrifice, out of the sacrifice came the Yajna Purush. If your sacrifice has been successful, you can actually see the gods in the sky. This is how Vedic sacrifices were done. You could see Indra, Vayu, Agni that you're invoking, they're coming. the smelling, the you know, the feast that you cooked for them. And Yagya Purush is a personification of the sacrifice itself and manifests itself also. Yagya Purush is Vishnu. It is described in Bhagavatam how Srila Maharaj Rishabha, he saw the Yagya Purush and all the gods included in this Yagya Purush, that they actually formed the different limbs of his body. So if you do a fire sacrifice according to the Vedic way, then you should be able to see all the gods. But if you only smell the smoke and you choke out of the smoke, like the sage at Nemisharanya, they say at Sutta Goswami, they say, oh Sutta, we are blackened by the smoke. It means that actually your fire sacrifice is not successful, because the flame should be pure without smoke and going upright, going towards the sky. Then that means that your sacrifice is being heard of. By the way, Sutta Goswami, he's also considered a Shudra. He was born Pratiloma marriage. Sutta actually is not a name, it's a title. His father was Romaharshan Sutta. And the Sutta Goswami that is described in Bhagavatam is Ugreshava, that is his name. Just like Vyas is also, it's not a personal name. The full name is Krishna Dvipayan Vyas, so he has a personal name. There's different Vyas and different Kalpa. So same thing for the Sutta. The Sutta is considered, I think the father was a charioteer. Sanjaya is also called Sutta. It's interesting because Shonaka is Brahman. His ancestors were not Brahman, they became Brahmana. And then he's a Brahmana and he's addressing Sutta Goswami as his master, or sinless one. And you have heard from your Gurudev, out of affection, they've given all the treasure to you, and you can extract all the essence of everything you heard, including Badarayan, because the word is being used actually when they address Sutta Goswami. You've heard from Badarayan Vyasadeva. So please tell us what is the essence of all the scripture. So they're addressing as a guru. They consider him as a guru, even though they were a first class Brahmana, just like Yamunacharya. He was a first class Brahmana, but his guru was a Shudra, considered born as a Shudra. This is just the external aspect. The Vaishnav origin has no importance at all. It is not what is important. What is important is how he has attained realization. If he really a Brahman, then he must worship Bhagavan and be a Maha Uttama Uttama Bhagavan, the highest kind. And many others. Example, Narottam Das Thakur, he was considered also, I forgot his, he was not a Brahmana, he was a Kshatriya, mixed Kshatriya caste, Kayastha. And he initiated two of his disciples were Brahmana. So according to the caste system, according to this rigid caste system, this is considered not correct at all. One question also can be asked about women, because yeah, Vidura also was a Shudra, but he knew it was. This was given actually, but you said first, you know, some Shudra actually. Yeah, woman. Are they qualified to read Veda, Vedanta? Same question. What do you think? Because we speak about twice born, three times born. Women, they're not twice born. They cannot be twice born. So what about Diksha?
Well, sounds to me like what you've said previously regarding Shudra. I mean, once they receive Diksha, they're not Shudra anymore, regardless of their birth, they're not Shudra, which is why you said the answer is no, Shudra doesn't study the Vedas, because they're no longer Shudra. So if I've received Diksha, but I'm still in the consciousness of, oh, I'm a woman.
What is your answer?
If I receive Diksha from Sadhguru, then yes, I must be qualified to.
And if you didn't? Because that's a tricky question. If you didn't receive Diksha, can you read Bhagavad Gita?
Well, Bhagavad Gita is part of
Mahabharata. Yes. Strishu Dhabi Rondanam. So, are you saved? Okay.
It's written for us.
Yeah. Okay. I don't have the answer, I'm just asking.
We're given the Gayatri mantras, apart from Brahma.
Yeah.
So, to be given those mantras is like about the highest thing that we can be given as well.
Yeah.
It's beyond everything. Karma Gayatri is beyond everything.
Yeah. So, Gopal Mantra, Karma Gayatri. Actually, once in Italy during a festival, Bom Maharaj was giving a lecture and he said that the Gopi Bhava mantra, you know, the mantra that sannyasi receive another line, very short, you know, you can read it, it doesn't have any potency if you don't get it in the book, but that woman can receive it also. He said, Bomma. So my wife, she went and she knocked at Gurudev's room and Madam Maharaj answered and she asked him, you know, said, I heard from Bom Maharaj that women can also get Gopi Bhava Mantra. So Madam Maharaj says, okay, so you can get from Bom Maharaj. So then she asked Gurudev, as he was coming back on the morning walk, he said, Gurudev, you know, I heard, you know, this, women get this Gopi Bhava Mantra. Gurudev sometimes was not hearing, you know, like properly, you would go like this and repeat, but this time he just answered right away. He said, yes, I give this. And he said, but I gave you already. Meaning Gopal Mantra is actually Kama Gayatri. I stopped there because another woman, she completely freaked out hearing this. So, but I told Bom Maharaj, because it wasn't sure. So when I saw him again, when I was traveling with him, I said, well, we still don't know if it is, because some people say no, Gurudev said no, it's not true, he said yes to you, but he meant no. So he showed me in Gopal Bhatta Goswami's book, Satkriya, he showed me in the Sanskrit, you know, I can read at least, I don't pretend that I can understand everything, but I can read. There was mentioned that one woman got the Gopi Bhava Mantra, I think it was Ganga Mantra.
Well, just on that subject, the...
Don't repeat it. But I don't know who. I don't know who Gurudev gave, you know, I have no idea. But according to Bom Maharaj, he was 100% sure that this is the case. So, but Gurudev's answer was even better.
Yes.
He said, I already gave you. Because we don't realize that this Gopi Bhava Mantra is to help, of course, to meditate, you know, I am a Gopi and so on and so forth. But actually, by the Gopal Mantra and Kama Gayatri, you're already reciting the same thing.
Yes. So can is there some parallel between that example and Brahma Gayatri? Because, as you said, Brahma Gayatri is glorification of Srimati Radharani.
Yeah.
And I expect most of us here have read Sridhamaraj's commentary on Brahma Gayatri.
Yes.
Which is
wonderful.
Amazingly,
yes.
Puri,
yes.
Radhadasyam.
Yes.
So, ladies also want to be Radhadasyam.
Yes.
And Gurudev, but he made it very clear. I mean, he said to me when he gave me Diksha, because in ISKCON I chanted it for 17 years.
Yeah.
When he gave me Diksha, he looked at me and he laughed and he said, you should not chant.
Yeah.
And you give the explanation that he increases Purushpa in ladies. But there's a glorification of Srimati Radharani.
Yes, but men needs to have this, you know, in other words, to
come. No, there's not good. What are they telling? Ladies are, once a month, the ladies are impure. So in that stage, when you chant the Brahma Gayatri Mantra, then the result is that your Purusha Bhava will increase.
What was the first bit you said? Ladies are impure.
Once a month.
Oh,
ladies.
Once a month.
Yeah.
So what about old ladies? Well, I'm an old lady.
You can try, yeah. But this is what, according to Srila Gurudev, is the reason.
So
So one,
it helps you to develop the proper mood, but if ladies, they are chanting it during the impure stage, then it, the opposite is the result, that you become very much like a, what do you call it?
Purusha.
You want to control others and you want to, and that is very bad.
Okay, so that applies during that period of time then?
Yes, yeah, but then there is something that is also there in this regard, that you'll have to chant it 3 times a day, so if you stop, and so all these things are considered. And like Gurudev said, it is not necessary also, because all these mantras, they lead, even before Srila Bhakti, Siddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, they were only giving Gopal mantra. Uh-huh. And then Srila Bhakti, Prakhyan Keshavara said, why you are not giving Guru mantra? And then all the other mantras also. Okay.
But
the other mantras.
But Brahma Gayatri was always there. Once those who are initiated in Dvija, you know, they get this.
In India, you get it from birth.
Not from birth. At the age of 8, at the age of 8 or 10 or 12, you get it. This is called second birth.
You hear ladies singing it on the train together.
Yeah, they're singing it.
Yes, I know, they're singing it now. But, you know, in this age of Kali, nothing really worked as it was, or as it should, you know. So, that's why it says that nothing Vedic can be actually of this age. It has to go through the Pancharatrik system. And even this Pancharatrik system is not the highest, because, you know, in the Parampara, there's two Parampara, the Pancharatrika Parampara and the Bhagavad Parampara. So this is another thing. Like this is a system to give you the right you know, to perform, because you need those samskara, and at the same time they're not the absolute. So I understand personally that Brahma Gayatri is not needed for women.
So Brahma Gayatri is a Vedic mantra.
Yes,
and our
yes.
Other mantras are not Vedic mantras exactly.
Yeah, you find Gopal mantra in the Gopal Tapani Upanishad.
Even in the end. Yeah. We don't chant these mantras anymore. When we reach perfection,
yes,
then
yes.
Only Hare Krishna Mahamantra.
It's
only helping to establish this sambandha with Sri Sri Radha and Krishna.
What do you think, Maharaj?
What he just said is, what I've understood is these mantras don't cross the Viraja River.
Yes.
Only the Hare Krishna mantra crosses the Viraja River, wow. So they give us that sambandha to reach purification in this world. But beyond there, for the more esoteric aspect, is the Hare Krishna mantra alone itself.
Yes.
Contains all that.
Actually,
the
Hare Krishna initiation is sufficient.
That is actually a real initiation, Gurudev said. But Srila Bhaktivinoda Swami Maharaj, he was very kind to encourage, and because it is actually necessary. Someone who has so many anattas, who is so much entangled in this world, they need all these diksha mantras. But someone who is not in that situation, like Haridas Thakur or Rai Ramananda, Sarva Damodar, they are eternally liberated souls.
Okay, so we also read the necessity for Diksha, Divya Gyan Shemam, the necessity at that point when the Guru gives the Diksha mantras. So we hear both things. That's where initiation begins, at that point. Because then you get the seed of Divya Gyanam and Shemam, all the bad things, then the karmas are taken. But that's not with Harinam, that's just with Diksha.
Mm.
So it seems that both things are there, and Harinam is sufficient.
Yeah, if we have not sufficient faith in Harinam, this is our problem.
No.
We have more faith in other things. But by Diksha mantras, our faith in Harinam will become stronger and stronger. Yeah. As we were reading and hearing this week about Bhajana Hasya, all this is related with Hare Krishna Mahamantra.
So then it's enough for somebody to receive Harinam and from a great soul, then that's enough.
Somebody should not be entangled in this world. Yes. If that somebody is hopelessly entangled in anarthas and worldly considerations and cannot get his mind out of this world, cannot go eternally, cannot go deep into the very nature of his identity, then Diksha mantras are obligatory. And that is, Gurudev gave a very nice presentation of this in Hawaii, where some devotees came up with this idea that Diksha is not really necessary.
and realize that it is a must. Giving us Swami has also explained this. It is very much essential, especially for persons like myself who are born in this, you know, material, hopeless, horror situation, and our minds is always thinking about that. How to become free from that?
Okay.
A question comes up. I heard that Kamalata Goswami and also Janava Devi, they were actually gurus in the beginning. They have accepted disciples, so what kind of mantras they were giving to their disciples, or even male disciples?
I don't
know. I think they didn't get sannyas mantra.
No, they didn't get sannyas mantra. I don't know.
Someone knows.
That was only Gopal mantra.
Gopal mantra.
I just wanted to share. I had darshan with Srila Bharti Maharaj today, and he spoke on this exact topic. Somebody asked him, and he said,
"Give him the mic."
He should have kept the mic.
I had darshan with my Guru Maharaj, Srila Bharti Maharaj, today, and someone asked him about the Diksha mantras, and he said the exact same thing you two have been saying. He made the exact same 2 points, that these mantras are specifically for freeing us from entanglement in the material world, and that they develop our faith in the Hari Nam. But he spoke for a long time about the glories of the Hari Nam, and he held that in such loving high regard. So I just wanted to share that because it was coincidentally the same topic.
There's no coincidence.
Again and again, Gurudev gave the example of the rice and the pot with the water boiling the rice. So Hari Nam is the rice. The rice is necessary, otherwise you starve, you know. The rice is everything. But without the pot of water boiling the rice, you cannot taste the rice, you cannot eat the rice. So that's how.
Yeah, first, I just wanted, before all that, to say that my understanding is also that this Gayatri mantra is actually to bring us to a sattvic state, so that the Maha mantra will have more power. I mean, if we are in a sattvic space, it's probably better to chant and to get the goal of the mantra.
Okay.
That's what I'm listening.
I've heard a few times Gopal mantra being mentioned here within the last few minutes. I heard that before Bhaktisiddhanta, I think, Gopal mantra had only 10 syllables. Is that correct? And it was changed to 18? How to explain that?
In Gopal Tapani Upanishad, it's given that this.
The short syllable,
short version, and longer version also.
So, all both?
Yeah, both.
Okay, so that's it for this year. And.
Yes, we want to thank from our heart, deepest core of our heart, Prakasatma Prabhu, Prakasatma Prabhu, for coming here. Last year, for the first time, we invited him, and that time we were not aware of his qualifications. We would visit him sometimes in his house, and he has a community. He's like a priest or a, how do you call these people?
Priest, huh?
Yeah. He looks after a congregation in the heart of Paris, many black people and many. So we would visit him, and we would never think that he's like a deeply learned scholar or whatever, but he's very quiet, and he goes about life very simple and easy and happy. But then we heard that he had done a study on Vedanta Sutra, and he has a PhD, so we invited him last year. He made a very beautiful presentation with PowerPoint, but not many devotees came. And so we had to select for this year another format. Last year we had about 13 or 14 teachers, six classes a day for 4 weeks. It was very attractive because there was so much PowerPoint presentation. There was a cooking course, there was a kirtan course, there was a yagya, how to do yagya and do the different things, deity worship, so many things, nice. But we decided this year to do it a little bit more simple and easy, because last year was like, it was all new for at least our devotees. Some of us have been in Bhakti Shastri course in ISKCON. I found it very helpful for the Bhakti. So we want to gradually move into that direction. So just for this year, we had selected five teachers, and one of them, Kishori Mohan and Sudevi, they were like last year very, very popular, and they made a very good presentation. Anyhow, they bailed out in the end because they had other obligations. And Prakasatma Prabhu said, I want to come again. I said, then we will include you again. But we didn't expect such a nice audience. He has many more jewels that he wants to share, like the Sandharvas also, right? You could present them. Yeah. Anything. It's very interesting, because although we all know what is the object, the aim and object, the goal of bhakti, but how the process exactly works and how we are entangled in this world and have different mentalities and ideas about Brahm and Brahman and Brahmana and what have you. Very interesting to hear. And Gurudev wanted that we should understand these subject matters very well. So again, we thank him from core of heart for being here, and we are very much looking forward if again next year he can be here, or maybe earlier. We will try to do this also in Vrindavan, in Gopinathbhava. And sometimes in West, in Europe, we also have selected the place, Krishna Chandra Prabhu's ashram, to give regular seminars, and he is not far from that. And we can invite him time to time there also. So much thanks, and we wish you a very auspicious journey back to your congregation, who are all receiving the Agyata Sukriti by having such a wonderful father who looks after them and helps them in their progress, their spiritual progress. It is said actually, Vaishnava Bhaktivinoda Kaur, that anyone who has faith in God, no matter what is his background, and anyone who is practicing sadhana bhakti, their consciousness is on the same level. Sometimes we think we are more privileged, which we are, but really, where is our consciousness? We should have strong faith in God. And many of these people I know, they believe in God. Many Christians, Buddhists, Muslims, whatever, they are not really steeped in the conceptions that we are presenting here. They are just simply looking for some area where they can deposit their faith, and they call it, like Gurudev always said, you can call your God Buddha, Allah, Jehovah, Krishna, no harm. Share the names and develop your faith and have ideal association. So his association is ideal for the all the people of Paris, And we wish him a very auspicious journey back to his congregation. Look forward to having his association again. Jai Sripad Prakasatma Prabhu Ki Jai. Ki Jai. Ki Jai. Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Veda Cha Pitana Pavanikya Vaishnavekya Namo Namah. So you have email address, right? If anyone wants to correspond or get more information from Prakasatma Prabhu and help, his email address is available with myself, or you can ask him also. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama,